You can order this episode 48 hours early on our Patreon, patreon.com/indieheadspodcast. By joining us for as low as $1 a month, you'll receive episodes early and gain access to our Discord server. All of our upcoming mainline episodes will be up on our Patreon 48 hours before it hits our public podcast feeds. But if you're hearing this via our Patreon feed, we thank you so much for your support. We especially want to thank our Real Ones patrons, including Becca Etienne, Georgia Mikowski, James Boss, Holiday Kirk, Tyler, Marcy Anime, Chance Holdup, Delaney Miller, Raina Cruz, Josiah Duncan, Jenna LaFleur, Matt Cameron, Grant the Back of My Dragula, Paulo Escobar's Hippos, Jackson Christ, Alec Felder, Matthew Taylor, Breen Hare, Drew Wharton, I Like Books, Jonathan David, Matt Kapuzinski, Mark Berry, Darian Fisher, Cal 50, No One's Refused Pimped Out Dave Matthews Event, Chris Wade, Jacqueline Cottiga, Midwest Maxwell, Kevin John, Jake Wald, Eraser Eye Baby, Rob Marino, Max, Dylan, Sandy Nemo, Waffle113, Gavin490Freak, and Maze Farms. To become a Real One, consider supporting us for $5 a month on Patreon or receive a bonus episode every month and get a shout out at the top of the pod. Anyways though, enjoy the episode.
Hello, and welcome to the Indieheads podcast, Twitter.com's number one music podcast, a site that is going to last forever, and we love interacting with our fans on there. And
oh wait, is there something happening on there? Hold on, let me check Twitter.
I don't think so. I think Twitter is normal, and there's nothing weird going on, and it definitely doesn't feel like the last day of school where everyone is like trying to get each other's numbers before. but anyways, we are here not to talk about Twitter.com, but we are here to talk about the internet, I suppose. And more importantly, we're here to talk specifically about the music of something that people like to talk about on the internet, which is anime.
Yeah, and hell yeah.
This is one of our Dave Roll tier playlists, which, in case you are new, Dave, we have a tier in our Patreon, patreon.com Indieheads podcast, where if you pay us a certain amount of money a month, you can select the playlist for us. We do these playlist curated episodes either from members of the podcast or from our listeners. And now, this time we had a friend of the podcast who's joining us today, Marcy, curate us a playlist of anime weeb classics.
Yes, that's me. Hello.
Hi, Marcy.
I pay these people money to listen to this music.
You paid us to listen to great music, Marcy.
Mostly great music.
Mostly great. Yeah, there is the caveat there. We'll get to that when we cross it.
You can hear all this stuff for free, but I just happen to give these people money so they can hear it.
Before we get into that, I want to make sure we introduce everyone else in this episode. I am joined by my co-host here, Natalie.
Hello.
We have Maddie, who's mostly just going to be in a producer role because this was painful for him, clearly. and then we have a special guest, which is us. Sam from the band Cheem is on with us right now. Welcome to the podcast, Sam. First time having you on.
Thank you for having me.
Last minute asked by me to get Sam on for this episode. I posted this in the Cheem court. I was like, wow, this is the worst song I've ever heard. And Sam's like, let me listen. And I'm like, Sam, you want to come on the pod and talk about this? And Sam said, sure. Here we are.
Oh yeah.
That's so rad. Like a song, it's like so bad in your head. You're like, hold on, I gotta get some other people on this.
The song in question too, I think I listened to it about 6 or 7 times today. So you've definitely captured a very specific mood throughout the day.
Brother, I've heard this song for years. This shit's like, I know this stuff with the back of my head.
Yeah, I knew some of it beforehand, but like that one was just like
we'll get into it.
Would it be helpful to right off the top go off of people's like familiarity with this sort of thing and like kind of where they're approaching it? Because I think we gotta contextualize kind of how our reactions here are coming. So
definitely.
I think Marcy obviously gifting us a bunch of this. I assume you're like very deeply familiar with like the actual like touch points and all the different like memes and videos that came out of all of these, correct?
Yeah, for the most part, yeah. This is all stuff that like just from like being on the internet and being like a huge ass nerd or whatever, like all these songs just like sort of come to you in a way. Like you don't seek them out per se. Like they just come to you. Whether it's like someone else posting them or like you see some like you see someone on Twitter, this new cool new website, just like talking about it and maybe hearing it for the first time.
Yeah, and I know that like my own sort of experience with this is like similar, where it's like I never like sought Caramelldansen out. It was like put upon me by like weebs I knew in freshman year of college, and who would just throw it on and like do the dance right there in person. And that's just kind of you kind of get like ambushed by it in real life. There's no like seeking it out naturally. It kind of just comes to you and then it just consumes you.
Yeah, I have a similar sort of thing where I didn't know a lot of the songs on this playlist because I was one of those like only watches Naruto type anime kids.
Let's go.
One of those people. I never really got super deep on a lot of these sort of reference points, but even though I did kind of, I was vaguely aware of a couple of these that we'll get to as we get to. But as I started listening to this playlist, I did not feel out of my element for two reasons, which is that one, I am a huge fan of like Eurodance and like just generally Eurotrash music of all shapes and forms. And I actually have an episode of that music that we will probably do at some point on this podcast. However, this combines that with another interest of mine, which is Porter Robinson's music, who famously a weeb, but also very famously Porter Robinson got into electronic music by playing Dance Dance Revolution. And there's a lot of Dance Dance Revolution-ass music in this playlist in a good way, including like songs that are literally in Dance Dance Revolution. And I do think that those two things prepared me very well for this playlist. Like I either knew the songs, like I know Caramelldansen, but which is our first song that we're going to talk about. But like besides that and a couple of others, like most of these I had not heard before, but then I immediately was like, oh yeah, I get the gist of this. Like,
yeah. I do want to like very quickly add on to my thing with like one other thing, which is when Marcy first sent this playlist, I was like, oh, I recognize like Caramelldansen and PONPONPON, and didn't really recognize, and like Simple and Clean Remix, obviously, but like didn't recognize a lot of them by name. And a lot of them, once I hit play on the playlist, I was like, oh fuck, I've like heard all of these before. And it's because just internet subcultures, I feel like, especially pick up on them, even if you're outside of anime circles. Like one of the songs that we'll get to is an infamous like SoundClown mashup fodder that was used in a lot of like Death Grips mashups circa like 2015. And so that's kind of one of the touch points that
I'm
I have.
I'm curious which one you're talking about. I'm aware of those, but I'm trying to think which one specific here.
Point it out when we get to it. But also just, I think once you like Jackie for the longest time, like I didn't really engage with anime when like those same people who like I got exposed to from this threw it at me in college and almost kind of like scared me away for good. And it's only now in like the last few years that I've kind of started to slowly approach it. And even still, it's like one of those things where once you kind of start dipping your toe in, it becomes like a lot of these I've like just ventured into just on random corners of like internet trawling just by pure accident because of getting into the medium in that way. They're kind of like inescapable in that way.
Yeah, yeah. So like my original intention with this playlist, because I was excited to submit something to the pod, first and foremost, I wanted something that would break a lot of y'all outside of your comfort zone, because y'all tend to cover some separate things from time to time, and I'm like, I'm gonna throw a left curve for y'all because I think that'd be fun. And in the process of doing so,
this is certainly a curveball. Certainly a curveball for me. All right.
Yeah.
To the point that I had to back out as host this episode.
I'm just gonna say it. It's not that much of a curveball if you listen to J-pop outside of your just in a normal space.
Well, I do not. So I only listen to butt rock and whatever I'm paid to listen to for this podcast. So, and also whatever publicists are paying me for the Indieheads subreddit, which now that Twitter is being shut down, I can reveal that secret. Publicists do pay me a monthly stipend every month to listen to their music and put it on my playlist and tell everybody to listen to that to that crap. Okay. So like, so really? Which unfortunately, you know, one of those people that did pay me is in this call right now. So, sorry, sorry, sorry to, sorry, sorry to reveal the grift, Sam, but you know, the jig is up. You know, Twitter's shutting down, the internet's shutting down. It's time to be truthful, which is why you should join Truth Social, the only social media site that speaks the real truth to power. I love my present. My familiarity with this music is very, very small and limited. Outside of, I think my few bits and pieces is like random hyper pop that's influenced by J-pop, and the Mount Eerie Real Death Nightcore remix. That is the extent of my familiarity with this kind of music. But Sam, what about you?
I kind of got into J-rock first, specifically like watching Naruto as a kid, and that kind of developed over time because I also have like a very brief or like very vast fascination for pop music. So a lot of J-pop just felt really natural to me, like especially was getting into it. The older I was getting, I feel like I got into like J-pop like older. Like I was not listening to J-pop when I was in high school. I was listening to Never Shout Never and the worst music I've ever heard. But yeah. I also really liked dubstep, like big was super into dubstep like when I was really young. So I'd say a lot of J-pop is very closely influenced by any sort of progressive pop or electronic music, and it still is that to this day.
I'm gonna say some J-pop could honestly, like, in theory have been an influence to dubstep itself rather than like it. I feel like it's a two-way street, like there's definitely some borrowing happening on both sides.
Yeah, I'm thinking specifically like progressive music in general, because like I don't know. I feel like everything that I've captured in the genre is like super intricate with its production, and it's fast. It's always moving. It's super maximalist, and I'm just a maximalist person. My ADHD brain is always waiting for the next thing to happen, and I feel like it's just perfect amount, the perfect touch for it. So yeah, I'm definitely into this shit. Yeah.
With that in mind, do we want to start diving into the songs themselves?
Yes, absolutely.
Yes.
Hell yeah. Especially because we're starting with an absolute, like, the other than, like, Simple and Clean remix, like, the classic, Weebcore banger.
Yeah, I had to start it off this way. There was no other song to start off with. It's freaking Caramelldansen.
Hell yeah, let's hit that shit.
So I listened to this playlist the first time earlier today, and my day has just been rough going since I had to listen to this. I try to save my being a hater stuff for things that actually deserve it, this is the most out of my element I've ever felt on this podcast, and this is a podcast where I'm consistently pushed to be out of my element. That's like the whole thing. Is that
this feels like coming home to me
in some ways. Yes, this is for some of y'all, this is sort of a homecoming, but for me, yeah, you know,
this,
like, I skipped the J-pop phase. I could have had a J-pop phase, but I never really liked anime growing up, and I got into Odd Future, so my time to get anime I guess that's not true. There's tons of people on rap forums that are big anime fans, but it was never meant to be with me. And this playlist was just was really just like, you know what? I made the right choice. I made the right choice to not get into anime and be a weeb. No offense to the weebs I just couldn't have survived in the trenches.
I'm just going to point out, because this is an audio podcast, I did just start instinctively doing the dance. I was the only one in the call doing it, and then immediately felt shame.
Yeah, everyone's in here. Everyone here has to do the dance at some point.
I love this song. This is so fucking great.
This song, it fucking rocks. It's only hitting me now as we're playing it back. It feels very... I just did an interview with a couple of artists talking about this. Like, this feels very, like, classic, like, happy hardcore. Like, this totally is just pure happy hardcore in terms of, like, the tempo it's going at here, the very insistent, like, thudding bass, the, like, pitched up, like, sunshiny vocals. It's I don't know, it's hard for me to, like, hear this, even with its, like, oversaturation without anything, but just, like, pure joy just because of how much it, like, embodies that genre to me.
Yeah, totally. Yeah,
they have Blumchen vibes, for sure. But, like, online. Online Blumchen.
Yeah, I love this kind of rave stuff. Like, I've been listening to a lot recently of stuff that sounds like this. I have a big theory that, like, trance and Eurodance sounds are gonna be, like, huge again at some point. Because, like, we're doing the jungle thing, and I don't think that's gonna be a fad. Like, I think that's kind of here to stay. Like, the jungle revival and all that stuff. But I also think that, like, people are gonna rotate back from breakbeats into, like, really proggy synths and really just, like... And I think that was one of the things I liked most about artists like Sophie and, like, the kind of originators of hyperpop is the way that they would take these sounds that were so sort of seen as cheesy, and they're not reclaiming them in an ironic way. They're just sort of like, what if the cheesiness is the point, and what if that can be, like, its own kind of thing? And I think this song is one of the most fun songs on the place. It's just so up, like, the up-tempo-ness of it is just, like, infectious. I can't not bop around to this song.
I know so many people that want, like, a real, like, Y2K revival to, like, pop off, because, like, there's, like, because, like, so many people like to mine that, like, certain era of stuff for, like, all, like, the sounds and music and, like, art and, like, just, like, all the stuff that was happening around that time, because it's, like, you know, because if you grow up in that, like, in that era, everything seems really cool to you, and, like, technologies, you know, it's so moving so fast, you know, we got computers, we got MP3 players, we got slime or something. That's pretty cool.
Yeah, I mean, there's clearly an attempt to, like, the Spotify Planet Rave playlist is them trying to place lame branding onto what is clearly a thing that's happening in electronic music, where the sound of pop and electronic are both throwing it back to that kind of Y2K thing, but also trying to, I mean, like, the Shy Girl album is a great example of, like, stuff that's very clearly influenced by this early 2000s rave stuff, but then trying to make it sound modern.
I don't check out Shy Girl. I always see them, like, as, like, a, if you like this, you will like Shy Girl. I'm going to put that on my list.
If you're a fan of Caramelldansen, check out this Shy Girl person.
I mean, actually, honestly, like, fucking, what's it called? Slime, or not Slime, no, that's from, Poison from the Shy Girl album, it, like, could be on this. It's, like, very kind of whatever. Trashy house music in the best possible way. The Shy Girl album is great. Pop music was allowed to become horny again in 2022, and I'm really grateful
Let's
for
go.
It. Anyways, but the Caramelldansen, great song.
I think the song's probably about, like, having fun or something. I don't think it's really that horny.
I don't think this song is horny at all. I think Caramelldansen is just, like...
We'll get to the horny song.
A song for having a fun time.
So, let's move on. Caramelldansen was pretty early.
I had some stuff to say about this.
Go ahead.
Oh, go ahead.
Yeah,
go ahead.
Okay,
sorry,
so,
about
like,
that.
A little background on this, because I know this is the first entry on this this Weeb playlist and stuff, but the people that are singing clearly aren't speaking any Japanese. That's Swedish.
Yes,
because the song is originally a Eurodance song from the band Caramel, I believe, from, like, the early 2000s. They break up, someone finds this song and decides to, speed it up, because speeding up things sounds fun. We like to call this thing, Nightcore in the trade.
Here's the original Caramelldansen. Yes. Oh, wow. Look, just for all of you either at home, or on this call, look up the pictures of the members of Caramel. Maddie, if you can pull up Caramel with two L's, that their Spotify page. Some incredible looks going on across these four members of Caramel.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so so the story goes, someone finds a song, speeds it up, pairs it with this a gift from that's, like, pulled from, like, some Japanese visual novel. I don't know the name of it, but it gets paired with that. I think it's posted onto 4chan originally, and it starts to pop off from there. it starts going viral a little, and then once it gets like noticed and picked up, the dance from the specific GIF like really catches on in anime fandom and whatnot, and then later on record company comes up and spins it up and makes a full blown like music video with like these weird looking, I don't even want to say anime girls because you just like look like off putting. It's very strange. I don't like if someone could pull that up here, the Caramelldansen video. But
we'll see. My internet's not the strongest right now, so I can find the video.
I can
link
picture it,
to
in
me.
My head. I don't need a video.
Yeah.
Same. And so they do the dance, and then like once like that video like happens, like it really starts exploding, and just becomes like just like weird wacky thing that people think of when they think about Japan and anime and all that. It's a really good video essay on YouTube about all the history behind this song and how it became like this big like meme thing. I forget the name of who uploaded it, but if you just search like Caramelldansen like video essay or whatever, I'm sure it'll come up. But it's had a wild history like from like the late like 2000s and has endured on to this day.
I'm not surprised to learn that it's a sort of remix of an actual Eurodance song, because it does sound too distinctly like that to be just a standard J-pop thing. Like, that totally makes sense to me.
Mm-hmm. All right, I'm not sure the YouTube video will load, because again, an hour before this podcast, my internet was out for a little bit, so. Nope. I had a little bit of a technical difficulty there as trying to play the music video for
let's go.
Let's fucking go, baby. That's the power of anime.
No videos. No videos, I think.
All right, we'll have to imagine them dancing in our minds. But if you can do it on the internet, honestly, that's the thing. Even if you don't think you know this song, you'll see them doing that little dance and you'll be like, okay, I've seen that. Yeah, I know what that is.
Yes, but let's continue. Did we want to move on to our next song then?
Yes, please.
Hell yeah.
Yeah, we can, yeah.
All right, what is our next song, Marcy?
Our next song is Butterfly by SMiLE.dk. I don't know why he spelled it like that, but we move.
Let's see. Will it play? 1 second. Now, even though I have downloaded these songs on my Spotify, they do not want to play. So we're going to stall for time really quick. Again, my computer and my just does not want to cooperate with me.
Elon Musk is trying to shut down our servers, you know, like
he heard us talking shit about anime.
I said I will not let you buy the Indieheads podcast Discord server, and this is what he's doing. He's hacking into me. All right, here we go. There we go. All right, perfect.
Yeah.
There we go.
Yeah. It's very funny, again, like, how much I can, like, link basically all of these songs to, like, a completely different subgenre that they're, like, kind of the exemplary one of. And this is, like, this one, where the last one's very happy hardcore, this one's very, like, bubblegum-based, like, mid-tempo sort of, like...
This sounds like Rednecks. This sounds like Cotton Eye Joe.
You're not wrong. No, it doesn't. Yeah. It's the fucking banjo. I'm specifically thinking of, there's an artist that I know that, like, Ada Rook, like, mastered an album from back in, like, 2020 called Ultra Happy Alarm. This sounds basically like a track off of that, and that's, like, just, like, pure bubblegum-based, like, nothing but like sugar-coated like songs like this.
Yeah, this is also up there for my favorite songs of this week. I love this one. It's great.
I love the little like wind chime like flute synth there.
Oh yes, absolutely. Do, 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 do. Yeah, it's great.
Also, yeah. This is also Swedish, I'm pretty sure, right?
I think this artist is also from like Sweden. Or I think actually hold on, let me double check.
I think this is German, I think.
Can we get to the bottom of why the biggest influencers in anime culture are all European?
That's colonialism.
Hey!
Colonialism in action,
just,
baby.
Just the sort of... There is a weird sort of connection between a lot of this, like, European dance music culture, and it is very weird to think about Europeans appropriating Chicago and Detroit music that's then being appropriated by Japanese people. Like, just the cycle of things that leads us to the music that
I don't even know
here.
If it's being appropriated by Japanese people so much as it's being appropriated by Americans who are fetishizing Japanese culture, and then it becomes associated with anime.
That's part of it. Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
So this song gets brought into Weeb culture and, like, you know, and just over to the West just generally, purely because it gets included into a game like DDR, which bulldozes, like, a bunch of weird, like, stuff from Japan, and also, like, just, like Eurodance oddities like this and many others. Like, I submitted this track kind of late, and because I wasn't sure, honestly, I wasn't sure, like, how many songs to put in here, so this is, like, my last edition, per se. But, this fits, like, firmly into the camp of, like, DDR core, which,
absolutely.
Which I could probably make it, like, its own playlist out of, because I think there's a lot of cool oddities that,
yeah,
like,
I was gonna say,
come out,
like,
of that game.
Referencing again to my Eurodance playlist that we probably will do at some point. As someone who on my, I recently started a playlist that's like my all-time favorite songs, just like songs that are like 10, 11 out of 10 all-timer songs for me. And as someone who every time we touch by Cascada is on that list.
Fuck,
like,
yes.
This song is great.
That and Sandstorm by Darude.
All-timers, absolutely, yes. We will talk about both those songs in a podcast one day, but I do like how this song fits into that. I also really like the chorus. To me, kind of sounds like ABBA is the vibes I get from
Ooh.
This song. Like the I feel that feels like an ABBA chorus. It could be.
Hmm.
It sounds like the music my gym teacher would make like all of us run in elementary school to.
Oh, that rocks.
What my gym did you go to? What, like, school?
My gym teacher...
I went to anime school,
I would go
course.
To gym class
to...
if this were the exercise.
Oh, my God. it's not Reliant
K. This were the waifu.
Is it Aquabath? That's right. My gym teacher on his playlist had a pool party by the Aquabats on there.
That's a very distinct memory I have. But if I was in school and my gym teacher was playing Butterfly like by SMiLE.dk, I'd be like freaking out. I'd be like, what the hell's going on? Like, how does he know this?
I wish I had a story like this. The only thing that I have is I came across like a Saint Anger meme yesterday, and it was like, it sparked a memory that the very first Metallica song I probably heard is Sweet Amber when a creepy shop teacher of mine had it on his like Windows Media Player. That's the only like music association I have.
Oh, I also checked out this album. This is like a compilation of just like Eurodance hits, and the first song on the record, Dub I Dub or Doobie Doob is how it's pronounced in the song, is literally just like Scatman core. Like, it's great.
Let's go Scatman. Love Scatman.
Love Scatman.
Be ba 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 da boo. Ba 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 da boo. Anyways, do we want to move on to song number 3?
Yes, let's
yeah.
move on.
Hell yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
All right, Marcy,
okay,
song number 3.
So to like just tail off on that song. So like that, this song comes out right around like the mid 2000s and stuff. So it's like anime, like fandom stuff, you know, before really, you know, the internet really happens. This song is much later. It comes out like, when did the song come out? Yeah, the song comes out in 2012. So it's a pretty big leap here. Wasn't exactly intentional like that, but, let's get into, PONPONPON by Kyary Pamyu Pamyu. An absolute banger.
Another just like, before you even set this playlist, I knew this one was going to be on it. Just because, like, how could it not be?
It's a banger.
Yeah, it's one of those songs that you hear that, like, is, like it just conjures the idea of Japan in your head and what that could be like.
Yeah. I honestly only recently learned about the song because, as Jackie has mentioned, some Porter Robinson core, and I know that she was playing the festival that he just mm-hmm. had. And I was like, who the fuck is this? And I was like, oh, this is so
yeah,
fun.
I've been aware of Kyary PONPONPON for a while, but have never taken the dive until when I was pulling this up, I was like, all right, I guess I'm going to really listen to Kyary PONPONPON finally. And then I pulled those up and I was like, oh no, I've heard this. Like, it was instantly recognizable to me. Because this is her biggest hit, it seems.
Yeah.
No, but she seems cool. Like, she's always been like, okay, I get it with like people that are obsessed over her. She seems very fun. I've heard her live shows especially are like insane.
I remember, like, when this song came out, because, like, I was, like, you know, I was, like, being on the internet, like, while all this stuff was happening, so, like, I remember, like, when everyone was posting about this song, because everyone's like, oh my god, this video is so wacky, this song is so cute, oh my god, this is so kawaii and all that, you know?
Yeah, I feel like I definitely came to this, like, from, like, big weebs when I was like still very weeb-averse, like sharing the video with me, and then it's like it just kind of hounded me everywhere across the internet. This is not the one I was talking about, but like the more I hear this song, the more I'm reminded that like I've probably almost like certainly heard this in like a SoundCloud mashup at some point, like in some places trawling the internet. Like, this isn't the one that I was thinking of where I have like the instant recognition of, oh, I remember where I heard this, but it's so omnipresent that it would not surprise me if that was one of the places it popped up at some point in my life.
I on her Wikipedia page, I was just like reading the like the public image section, and there's a thing where they say that Kyary Pamyu is often called Japan's Lady Gaga, and once I read that, I was like, ah, yes, that makes sense. Apparently, media outlets call her fashion monster, like it. It makes sense to me that the kind of connection there, that she started around the same time as late like 2010, and represents that kind of just like kind of almost caricature of some of those like cultural, some of the styles of J-pop music, and how it's just sort of blown out to like proportions the size of her giant bows that she wears on her head.
Yeah, like the idea of like cute stuff in Japan has been around since like anyone's like heard about anime like over there.
Exactly.
But like this song in particular just like fully just like maximizes all of that, like, and like that's like it's still the kind of idea that like persists to this day. I have a belief that if you want to shout out another song here because I think it's fun, you probably would not get a song like let's say Avril Lavigne's Hello Kitty without a song like this.
Oh fuck, you're right.
Oh god. Oh. Pain.
Oh, that song's great. That song's fun.
I can't follow you there. I can follow you like everywhere else that this playlist has been going, but I can't follow you there, Marcy. I'm
I say
sorry.
That knowing it, I'm not actually sure if I've heard the entire song in full because I probably couldn't stand actually hearing it, but I think it's cool.
Certainly one of the first times I've heard that stance.
Yeah. Weirdly enough, like putting this like playlist together, like I sort of had a realization that this is like the only like just like pure J-pop song that's actually in here, and mm-hmm. It kind of made me think how like J-pop, like obviously there's a lot of like crossover between like J-pop and like anime fandom, but in my head it's always seems like it's like been like sort of like separate things, like they're not exactly hand in hand. Like if you're like into anime stuff, you really have to like dig in and like create your own space to like get into all like these J-pop groups and all that, like, and even and it's like even it's even like separate from like all like the like all the K-pop fandom that like we've come to like nowadays. Mm-hmm. Like
it is definitely
like that stuff usually doesn't tend to like cross over, but like if you're like if you get into like anime, then like maybe you just like hear those Kyary and like maybe you know get into a group like Perfume per se. And like then you're going down to this whole other road of like stuff that like, you know, is cool and exciting.
Yeah, the world of K-pop is very separate from the world of like people being really into Hikaru Utada, who we'll get to later, and stuff like that.
Yeah,
like, that queen. Feels very separate.
The queen.
Yeah, we'll get to her later, but yeah.
Well then.
All right, let's move on.
Yeah, song number 4, Marcy. What is it?
Next song here, this is a banger here as well. We got Fly Away by TeddyLoid.
Hell yeah.
What if I just started playing the Lenny Kravitz song instead? What if I just did that instead?
Or the Neil version.
Or the Neil version. we already did that joke, though. I'm pretty sure I already did that joke during the 90s rock number one series.
You did, but it would be funny to do it again.
Yes.
This one fucking rocks. I had forgotten that I was already familiar with TeddyLoid because as Marcy and I keep talking about in like every single time I bring this playlist up, like the one touch point that we don't have here on the playlist that I think is like very vital is Me, which TeddyLoid is also on and is like, it was this like big like cataclysm that like really kind of shook basically every online anime circle I was on in like 2014. But like hearing this is like really wild because this one's from, when did Penny and Stocking and Garter with Garter Belts? That was like, okay, 2010.
Yeah.
So it's cool to see some of those origins and kind of how it, a lot of the basis for that kind of is in here, albeit like a much more like straightforward song than that one.
Yeah, yeah. I considered putting Me on here because it did have like that big impact in that moment, but I picked this one mostly because I felt more of a jumping off point, and it came out in such a specific era where like I think at this point in the playlist, like it's like where like it's more like the anime fandom and like let's say like EDM and stuff like kind of like converge into like in a way. Yeah.
I was immediately gonna say like, there's no way Madion didn't hear this, right?
Oh, he definitely heard this.
Like,
showed in the song.
So much future funk is you can hear in this song. I mean, like, coming right out of the Bloghouse era into the kind of sort of early 2010s SoundCloud dance music era and people like Porter and Madion, like, the connection right here is very obvious. And also, this song... that reminds me of cool new stuff that's now happening in this space, like the Hadna album from this year, especially.
Ooh,
like,
yes.
Hell this yeah. Definitely sounds like it could be on the Hadna album, except if it was, like, it would just, all of a sudden, the beat
it'd be chopped to hell.
Yeah, exactly. Destroyed and fucked up and whatever. Like, but I do like this all. All the synth textures are really nice.
I think this definitely...
They're all obnoxious in a non-grating way, which is really the name of the game here. It's like how loud and like excessive can you make the synth without having them be like actually grating your teeth.
It's like farty, yeah, in the best way possible.
Yes. Mm. Definitely.
Yeah. Yeah, no, like I was gonna say, like, you could definitely draw a clear line to not only like kind of where this goes into like Japanese electronica and like the future, but also I'd argue like a lot of like just Korean electronica too, and kind of like the different ways that it's kind of been chopping up and doing stuff with these kind of like really big like synth and bass sounds and kind of fucking with a lot of like big beat influences, that kind of thing. Like I hear a lot of that and kind of like what a lot of artists right now are doing like in this song.
Yeah, yeah. TeddyLoid himself is like someone who's like he's been like that guy who's like introducing these kinds of sounds to like, you know, like Japan and like Japanese music. Like, I'm just like, I think about like what like anime con raves were probably like back in the day, like before like the 2010s or so, where they're probably like listening to like stuff like Caramelldansen or like Butterfly. But like, I think once this song comes out and like suddenly like things just change. Like, everyone just wants to dance and everyone just wants to have a good time. Like, everyone's like partying. Everyone's in. Some reckless stuff was happening at those anime cons.
This is definitely the turning of the page from 2000s dance rave sounds to 2010s rave sounds.
Yeah. This is a good song. It's hard for me to like really like think about these songs, yeah, like critically in that way, because like of course I know what this song is. Like, I've heard it like so much. Like,
no, totally.
It was really for me to say
about it. Theme songs are, it doesn't even really feel like a song from an artist. It's more just this thing that kind of exists ambiently in the culture, whatever, on the internet.
Yeah. It's honestly, it's kind of difficult for me to talk about the first, like, 8 songs here, because they're just all, like, I feel like I'm, like, recycling the same, like, this is good. This is just, to me, like, what a lot of, like, electronic and pop artists have kind of been taking as influence for the last, like, nearly 2 decades. But, like, we'll get into it because we're about to dive into, I think like soon is where things kind of take a shift to the interesting zone of things.
All right, let's move on to our next song.
Yeah, yeah. Let's move on.
Song number 5. This is Japanese text I cannot read.
This is Nice Circulation. If you want a song name there.
Hell yeah.
All right, thank you. All right, let's play it.
Let's play that shit.
I'm very familiar with the song, but I try my very hardest to figure out where that familiarity is, and I'm stumped.
I can answer my own familiarity, because this is one where as soon as I hit play, I'm like, oh, it's this fucking song. This is the one that is used in so many just like SoundClown things that I got associated with like over the years, the point where it became like a meme in and of itself. Not for like what it broke out with, because I know that like the whole like Monogatari like hive of anime is like such an entity into itself that like merits an it merits a conversation we're not even going to get into on this podcast, probably.
No, we will not. I have not actually seen the anime, but there's so much there that we will not get into.
But suffice to say, it like it grew out of like this very vast, devoted like anime fandom network, and then kind of because of that ubiquity hopped over into like ironic meme posting, to the point where I pinpointed the exact place I remember hearing this for the first time, and I'm dropping it in the Discord right now.
Alright, we're gonna
I will try to play this, Natalie.
This is how I know it.
Hopefully
this is how I know the song.
Hopefully this doesn't break my computer.
I've seen that meme.
I'm just gonna pause and I'm just gonna hit play on this and hope to God my internet is good enough.
Let's go. Come on.
Okay.
Yes.
So far, so good. We're not gonna say
this
what
is very
it is.
Normal.
Just. I close my eyes and seize it. I clench my fist and beat it. Yeah. My torch
and burn it. Yeah. For me, I worship.
I close my eyes and seize it. So great. I clench
my fist and beat it. Hang on. There might be a better one. Let me see.
There we go.
Okay, yeah, hang on. This one has way more views. It's not the same one.
The thing is, there's an entire subgenre of SoundCloud that's just putting death groups over anime songs.
I've gone through so many. I've heard so many fucking death group mashups through my day.
It's because I've identified this through Rave DJ. Because so many death grip songs have no actual key, and also don't have like they have all like Tachyon and like Guillotine especially have so much negative space in the mix that it makes it very easy to mash up with stuff, because like you can just throw a melody over it and there is no real melody to like Tachyon. So
they also have such very clear like stress syllables in the vocal track.
And MC Ride is just like a great rapper. Like he's so on beat.
But I'm not immune to this. Like in my day of like trying to be like a SoundCloud adjacent like person, I've definitely fed into the machine of this. If anyone can hunt that down and find it and send it to me, I will ask you how you tracked it down in that way. But I'm not going to be surprised.
Yeah, my big review of this. So I'm not familiar with this anime, or I had actually not heard that mashup before. I enjoyed that very much. My big thing was I was just like, Mario Party. That was just the vibes I get from this song. Like either Mario Party or Mario Kart, or also like Animal Crossing. I think there's certain like there's so many Nintendo games that have the songs. Like you know what it is? It's those little horns. Like those horns feel so like Nintendo game soundtrack.
Yes,
like kind of.
They feel 16-bit. Yeah.
Or no, but like more the late period like Wii Sports Nintendo music. Mm. Like you could imagine that playing while you're playing Wii Tennis or whatever.
See, yes. I feel like it's a kind of instrumental that's like made in Mario Paint.
Oh yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's it.
This song is the one that feels close to like Shibuya Kai. Like it's just very adjacent to like jazz in a very strange way, with like all the horns, and, like the we love the brass, we love the brass here. So
shout out to those horns.
Yeah. Unfortunately, it's one of many things that's tainted by this guy being a creep now that I think about all the time. Anyways, but Gabriel Gundacker's videos where he would make themes for Wii Sports sports that don't exist. All of that music sounds kind of like this.
Yeah.
See, to me, like, I mentioned this in the chat, but, like, the main touch point for me is this feels, in terms of drawing the, like, lineage of, like, each of these songs, like, a contemporary artist, this feels very, like, Wednesday Campanella, which is this like Japanese pop hip hop group that like blends a lot of like rap, electronic pop, like big band influences.
Oh my god, I just pulled it. Okay, I'll link it. Maddie, if you could play just like the first 20 seconds of that real quick, you'll see what I mean.
Yeah.
This is the main theme to.
You don't know how many times I play this game.
It feels like coming home. It feels like coming home.
But yeah, very clearly.
These cats are cooking. We're swinging.
There's Kurobsy right over this.
Yeah, it, like this influence of like jazz lounge music with like J-pop kind of influences.
I love the Weeb.
Oh, wait, now we're gonna get into tangent because now I'm thinking about the fucking the Wii Shop channel video.
Oh, Wii Shop Wednesdays.
Yeah, we're diverting so much from this song. We're getting at some other shit here.
We are just going down the rabbit hole.
This is the end of the rabbit hole. We're gonna
watch. This is the power of Monogatari.
We Shop Wednesdays, and then we move on.
Okay. We actually are going to watch We Shop Wednesday. Okay, I mean, hold on.
Listeners, if you haven't watched We Channel Shop Wednesdays, this is probably
maybe feel like a Bossa Nova beat
from Nirvana the band, the show.
This is the best. This is the show ever. I will just like to say.
Matt, yeah, update day.
What?
New Wii titles.
What? I'm in the bathroom.
Update day for the Wii Shopping channel.
It's funny because normally they do it at midnight, but it's like 11. It's like 11:15. What time is it in Japan? Turn that up. What that grooving? What kind of music is that? Like a bossa nova?
Okay, boss. I'll turn it up.
I really want to just croon it. This is such a dance.
Yeah, it makes
song.
Me really like croon it.
This is us on this episode.
The thing is, they're so true about this.
We should write a song for our act with titles of Wii games.
You know what I just realized this is?
Because everybody knows about the Wii Shopping Channel.
Natalie.
And everybody loves
this is just the first 20 minutes of Ishtar.
So what we'll do is we'll write a theme song for the Wii Shopping Channel.
I haven't actually watched Ishtar.
the opening part of Ishtar is the two of them, like, riffing songs, and it's just like, they're like Super humming out songs Mario themselves, 3. And it's so bad. And
Mega
like,
Man, Neo,
that is the
Dirt
dynamic
Masters,
they're playing off of. I have
that,
to be.
That rocks.
Like every start, you say the lyrics of the.
Let me try one. Super Mario RPG. Sonic the Hedgehog 3. Adventures of Lolo 1 and 2. Here's a sidekick, Doug, Jumanfu. Harvest Moon. Something puzzle Pokemon. Toe Jam and Earl in Panic on Funko.
Just a perfect video. No,
we should. We should have a playlist that's nothing but the Wii Shop Wednesday song, like 10 times in a row.
I think I watch this every Wednesday, and I don't like to admit that. But it's the best video I've ever seen.
Wii Shop Wednesday probably pairs very well without a touch Thursday.
And Donkey Kong Jr. Max. Ninja Gaiden 3.
Chris USA.
this is just perfect.
Wow! I kind of ends on that.
Incredible.
If anyone's friends with Sky right, on Discord, the end of that video is his Discord profile pic. Now you know.
Oh hell yeah! Oh, and one more thing before we go into our next song, because I just want to hear what this is. What this sounds like, just to go back to our first song really quick, now that my YouTube is working.
I'm telling you, just like match up any song with Death Grips and just give you free air and it points back in the day.
No,
exactly.
Like, don't spoil, you're supposed to spoil. Well, let's see what the song is though. This is way better than the original.
Yeah, this is what Year of the Snitch sounded like.
I mean, this is not that different from Steroids.
This is just Gabber.
This
no,
is true.
Caramelldansen is Gabber.
I'm a big fan of MC Ride drawing.
That's maybe why it grew on me over the repeated listens to the playlist.
Gabber
I was like, okay,
Nightcore,
this is not
very
as
different
bad.
Things. There's a very important distinction there. I will not. We're gonna.
That's fair. That's fair. Oh that's God. Very reductive of me. I'm retracting that.
I'm being
okay.
Right there. I'm getting.
Okay, let's move on. Let's move on to our next song. What is our next song, Marcy?
Our next song. This is a fun one. We got triple baka here. Have you heard about this person named Hatsune Miku?
Hell fucking yeah, baby.
Let me just okay. Wait. I'm just gonna say, it was genuinely hard to think of like okay, I gotta pick like one Vocaloid song to be on here. This sounds tough. And ultimately what I did was I picked the song where they say baka a lot because I think that's funny.
Yeah.
Yeah. This fucks. I am the mark for this one as the girl who famously will not shut up about like one of my favorite artists who uses Vocaloid. And so like this is just right up my alley. And also this is like, dare I say, the song on this playlist that I think goes the hardest. Like, just the incessant tempo and that, like, synthetic snare hit is just so fucking fun. And it's also a minute 30. It's, like, nice and just quicken in.
Out. Really get in, get out there. I know it's just an hour, minute 30. That's fun.
Sometimes it's all you need for a song. The shorter, the better, in my opinion.
This reminds me, Marcy, I gotta throw you, if you have not already listened to Twinkle Park, I should throw Twinkle Park at you.
Well, I'm aware.
Okay. Good. We're on good terms then.
I love that like eighth like synth that's kind of following the vocal the whole time. It's very
yes.
chaotic.
It feels very early 2000s electronic. Like,
yeah.
I'm trying to figure out. It feels almost kind of like something you would hear in like.
This is not the. I just realized it's not the full version.
It's not the full version.
There's a whole. Yeah, there's a whole. There's like more song.
Yeah, that one's fun.
Do I dare find it?
I don't have a lot to say about that one.
I mean, there's
but...
the iconic video you could be watching for this.
The iconic video?
Video.
Okay. Oh, I guess I'll pull it up really quick.
A big thing with like Vocaloids and like the Vocaloid fandom is like a lot of these Vocaloid songs had like animations like people made for them, whether it was by like the people that made the song or like just like people just making fun animations for the song they like. There's so many of these, like it's become such its own like big culture. Just people obsessing about these characters that make the like funny little like robot noises. That's me being a little I'm being cheeky with that. I love Vocaloid stuff. There's so much good Vocaloid stuff out there if you're willing to like look out for all of it, because like there's so much.
Yeah, this kind of gives me Sonic Adventure Soundtrack 2 vibes a little bit. Not quite as rockin', but like that same sort of driving like energy to it.
This feels like to me it straddles the line between like hyper pop and just straight up like noise pop sometimes, with just some of the nastiness and some of the mix. Like,
okay,
it is
a little rougher. Like, it's not as like cleanly mixed for sure.
Yeah, there's not like a limiter on some of the like higher end stuff going like you would typically expect from this kind of thing.
I get the digi like some digi chord vibes just with like the constant ringtones that I feel like are just going around the song. It's very cool.
Okay, you know what this feels like to me? This feels very Ape Escape core. Like this
oh,
is
fuck. That's it. Yeah,
that's you need something like that kind of level of hyperactive and that kind of like it feels very much like some of the stuff
it
that
also,
Sochi Terada is doing on that soundtrack. Yeah,
I was also trying to figure out what it reminds me of melodically. It's kind of Take On Me, but aha.
Ooh, Take On Me Nightcore.
Oh, that's some fun.
Take On Me.
Yeah, it's hard to me to like pinpoint a thing just reminds me of, because I really just do think of it as like Vocaloid music. That like that's like its origin point for me.
No, totally. And I, similar to many people, once I got into Porterompt, and like I immediately got into like, oh yeah, this Vocaloid shit is cool.
Well then, let's move on to our next track. What is our next song, Marcy?
Our next song here is another iconic banger, Bad Apple here.
Hell fucking yeah, let's go.
A lot of these songs are like best paired with like the video that's on YouTube, like, because that's mostly what catches on, especially with this song, because like the video in itself is like iconic on its own.
Yeah, it really is, like, because especially a lot of these, and I feel like a lot of like this particular generation of weeb culture is so inherently wedded to like either early internet video with what we were talking about with like Caramelldansen originating on 4chan, or like very much like those like first several years of YouTube from like 2006 to like 2013, 14-ish. And that's definitely the case here. This one to me just reminds me of something that like Haru Nomori would do. Like, this feels very, the like very sort of like skittering noisy electronics and the like kind of hard rock influences on top of the pop stuff is like very much like, it feels very much up that zone.
No, totally. Yeah, it's very kind of post-bloghousey electro house stuff, like kind of Bloody Beat roots adjacent.
I was going to say the exact same thing. Very, it feels very close to that time period too, like 2008. I bet this came out.
Exactly, like the synth texture is very like Boys Noize type, sort of distorted, blown out, like compressed to hell, late 2000s, early 2010s blog electronic music.
Yeah, like I call it like disgusting house or something.
Yes,
like that.
Absolutely.
I think I looked it up, and I think this song in this video got posted to the Japanese website Niko Niko Duga, which is like their like YouTube equivalent over there, in like around like 2008. So yeah, it is around that time.
I don't know. I'm just really good at years or guessing the age of something. So let's go.
Yeah. The visualizer for this thing is sick.
Oh, it's so good.
I will say also of this playlist, is definitely the most heavy bass distributor song on the entire list. Definitely the most dubsteppy.
I'd say so. Yeah.
Yeah, so this song specifically comes out of the fandom of Toho, which is a game series.
Yeah.
Created by the man named Zune, game developer.
This is shockingly well animated for 11 years ago. If you're at home, go watch the Bad Apple video.
No, it's great. A video game series based around like the shoot 'em up games were notorious like PC shooter things, like not like a Call of Duty or Quake sort of thing, but more like a shooter where you're like you're just like shooting a bunch of bullets in bullet hell.
Yes. Oh my god, that reminds me that like another thing that feels very much of this culture that like we didn't talk about was Owen Was Her, that sort of like very much like very fast paced, like almost kind of I don't really know what genre to describe it as, but like it's very high tempo, like very like quick paced, like percussion heavy, like chirpy synth sort of stuff. But it's like that's another thing I very much associate in terms of like online weeb circles.
Yeah, just Toho in general is like so widespread, because the thing with Toho is that like Zune is very lax specifically with like fan work with the game, so like you can just do whatever with like all the characters and all the music you want. You can make like games, you can make music and like whatever. Okay. Basically, and because of that, like there's any music genre you can really think of, there's probably someone make like relating it to Toho in some way. Like there's some there's someone out there who's like making some like sludge metal stuff, and it's about like Toho characters and whatnot.
I love the fucking harsh noise, like little interjections here. It feels, you know what this feels like to me? I put it together. This is like a health song.
Yes. Oh my god, it does sound like health.
Oh fuck. the drums specifically do sound like health.
Yeah,
absolutely.
It's the drums and like the little like interruptions of noise with the like very clean vocals. Yeah.
The 808.
Yeah,
what the fuck are you talking about? I mean, you all know more than me, I guess, on health, but even then, it's like, what?
I'm not sure
imagine, like, remove the vocals entirely, and imagine, like, you have screamy vocals over this, and you also replace the kind of whooshy synth with, like, something a little more menacing, like the bass line and the drums and all that is very much like kind of industrial electronic.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, I would agree.
Yeah, like this is the one that I feel like, honestly, like not to reduce it to this, because like I have been like a big thing with me with this episode has been like wanting to very much root it in the kinds of like Japanese music cultures that a lot of these songs come from, because I feel like they're kind of inherently there. It's like not necessarily like it removing it from that like kind of puts it in a different context, but like this is definitely the case where it's like the instrumental here, like aside from the like kind of like chiptune synths, is like very much you could just like put this in like an electro-industrial like band in like any sort of like nationality and it would like feel completely at home.
Mm-hmm.
Really, it's just all it is it's just that like chiptune and the vocals are the only thing that like really kind of signify it being like what it is.
Oh yeah. All right,
but that's okay, Maddie, because we have the most recognizable song here.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, no, I recognize this one like a mile away. Not this version of it, but I did recognize the song right away. What is our next song, Marcy?
Next song we got all time classic here. Everyone rise for the national anthem. It's Itsukartaru's simple and clean PLANITb, specifically the PLANITb remix.
This is very DDR core. This is like, because I'm pretty sure this one might have been used in like an actual DDR game, if I'm remembering correctly. But like, we gotta just get off the bat. Hikaru Utada is the GOAT. Their music is just like so incredibly like cool of a blend of like different like pop and rock influences. Icon from the days of Kingdom Hearts all the way up to Bad Mode, which is one of the best albums of 2022.
That was so good. That album is so good.
Fucking Somewhere Near Marseille is just like takes me out every single time.
The thing about the album Bad Mode by Hikaru Utada, and many people are saying this everywhere I go on street corners, I hear people saying that they should have called it Good Mode because it's a good album.
It's so good.
Yeah, I listened to some of the songs of that when it was coming out. I was it's beautiful. Beautiful record.
Really, really sick record. Yeah, absolutely. It has like an insane cast of people, like Floating Point worked a bunch on that record, like Skrillex, like all of these crazy
characters.
Yeah, that's why I listened to it too. I was like, oh my god, A.G. Cook.
Well, that's the thing. That's like, Hikaru Utada's reach.
I remember when I like saw the news that both Hikaru Utada and Eiji Cook linked up to make the new song for the Final Evangelion movie, and my brain just kind of exploded. Like I was like, me and my partner were just like both in shock. Like, is this real? Is this a thing that's happened? This feels like it's not true. Like, and also the song's like super good. It's so fucked up.
Yes, the remix just fucks it up all the way. It's like really like we should have all seen like Hikaru Utada like non-binary era coming like the second this remix dropped, because this is just like this in a lot of ways is very much pioneering the kinds of like weird gender fucked like electronica that would come in like the late 2010s.
True, there's some androgynous to it, which is why it has always encaptured me.
This song specifically, like, to me, like, I definitely want this song in here because it feels like a very, like, starting point for a lot of people to many different things, whether it's, like, playing Kingdom Hearts and then, like, getting this, like, opening up, slapping it into your PS2, getting the intro to that game, like, with this song playing and just having your mind, like, kind of just, like, blown apart because, like, just there's so much happening all at once and, like, you can't get enough of it. And then so, like, you're searching, like, all any Kingdom Hearts stuff you can find. Then you start maybe getting to see some anime. Maybe you start listening to some other trance music around the time. It's getting electronic music in general.
I already like this song, but then this remix hitting me at the phase where I am listening to more trance than ever before. Oh, so good.
Like this song more, I think, out of any song, is probably what got a lot of people to start being like, oh, I want to make music like this. This inspired like all like the Porter Robinsons of the world to start like.
And when I saw Porter live during the virtual self tour, he plays an edit of this remix in the virtual self set that's really sick.
Oh, really? That's so cool.
He plays a lot of edits in those sets. There's a lot of good stuff.
Yeah, he takes like a lot of classics and like reworks them a little bit to fit into the set.
Yeah, I could have potentially thrown like the Lane theme in here if I wanted to.
God, yes, that what's that fucking song called? It's that song is just so iconic.
I forget the song is called.
Yeah, if you have a chance to see Porter, I'm sure he's gonna tour it more soon again. But the Porter virtual self shows are so goddamn sick.
Yeah, I just want to very quickly shout out the Lane theme, which is done by, I believe it's like some European band.
It's Boa, right? Yeah,
it's Boa. Yeah, and it feels very like it's kind of like weird, like cusp of the millennium, like singer songwriter core. It rocks. It is just it is like one of the best anime openings of all time for good reason. But with this song, like when I got to this on the playlist, I was thinking to myself, like, familiar with this remix. I was like, do I prefer this to the original or do I like the original? I was like, I don't know, the chorus in the original is so iconic. And then the chorus, like the way this drops into it in this remix, it's just like there's no comparison. Like, I love the original death, but this is like this, the way it just weaves its way into it just hits so goddamn good.
It's so much fun. It'll go off on like any party you play. If you just throw this one out there and everyone's having a good time.
Yeah, like another song that Porter plays in the virtual self live set is Castles in the Sky by Ian Vandal, which is like an absolute anthem if you've never heard it. But yeah, like that's similar vibes of very trancey music combined with like super epic pop vocals, like very like trying to be like basically taking the energy of like your classic disco anthem and translating it to this very Y2K like production style in a certain way.
Yeah, shout out to all my to all the Kingdom Hearts heads out there. I see y'all are great.
Yeah,
I'm not actually doing well. I'm not actually a head. I played like 1-2 Chain of Memories, but like some of that sticks in your head forever.
Yes, it does.
My partner is big on the Kingdom Hearts series. They have a lot of fun with that shit. It's big gender stuff with them as well. Mm. Those shout out.
No, that totally makes sense. Like one of my friends is a giant Kingdom Hearts head and like has a lot to say about it in terms of like her own like trans shit. So that's shout out to Kingdom Hearts, the one trans thing related to Disney that
shout
like
out my Now my friends Sora, Donald, Goofy, the homies.
She let me hit because I'm Goofy.
Oh God!
On that note,
Let's move on. Marcy, what is our next song?
This next one's a fun one. This next song is "Get Her," Rockefeller Street. In parentheses, new Nightcore # Rockefeller Street. That's the name on Spotify, but the group Get Her Jaani.
This to me it just feels classic Nightcore. Like this,
yeah,
is,
y'all hear about this Nightcore thing?
This is just like the purest kind of like thing for Nightcore for me.
Yeah, this was another one where I'm like, oh, okay, I know this one right off jump.
Interesting. This is the one you knew like from the jump.
Yeah, that's kind of impressive.
From where, I don't know, but this one was like very familiar to me for whatever reason.
Maybe you just maybe it's just the association with Nightcore.
Yeah,
I will say the original song, this is like when it slowed down. It was a Eurovision entry from I think the country Estonia.
That might be it. The little like effect, the way the toms are mixed, especially in the Nightcore thing, is so fucking cool. This is also important note. This is the last good song on the playlist.
Oh God!
This is the point of no return, and so I'm enjoying this even more this time around. Especially that like screamed noisy passage, which again feels very like Haranomori-ish.
So yeah. So this song in the playlist introduced, or I guess Caramelldansen is you could technically call it a Nightcore song, but it's a whole weird thing and. We'll get into that exactly, but this song is definitely just Nightcore. It is an original song, just sped up in tempo, and just brings it like a whole new different kind of energy. Nightcore, a big internet staple.
You know what I should do? We should curate a a way to bridge the gap, Maddie, between your interests and these interests, and I should do Nightcore remixes of butt rock songs, like the Nightcore Angel.
Yeah.
Like the Nightcore Angel with a Shotgun remix, which is very famous.
There's tons of that shit.
There's
like,
a Nightcore
could,
blurry
oh,
out
man.
There for sure. That little, like, weird, like, electro swing bit.
I was going to bring up electro swing, but the Nightcore Angel with a Shotgun remix has 241 million plays on YouTube. Well, hold on. I'm going to do a very important Google search that I will type aloud. Lips of an Angel Nightcore.
Oh, my fucking God.
Send tweet. Let's fucking go. Let's fucking go.
Of course there's more.
Oh, Matt, real quick, before we move on.
Yeah. I mean, hey, if anything to keep us from our next song, honestly.
Yeah.
Next song, which I mean, here's the thing. Our next song, I'm going to play this really quick. The next song we're going to play after this, it may be the worst song I've ever heard through this podcast.
I don't know.
You can't say that for sure because we've listened to a lot of music over the past like 2 years or so, but it is certainly up there in terms of just visceral hatred.
Yeah. Also, if anyone's interested in ever doing a Nightcore version of the team,
they can't.
I'm welcome it.
He still has the fucking like the rasp, the classic butt rock raspiness. Can't get rid of that.
I do have a video I want to submit to the audience that this is an artifact attached to Rockefeller Street, particularly. Let me just post in here.
Oh boy.
Oh fuck, God.
It's not a remix per se, but it is one iconic thing.
I really don't mean to keep doing this, but as I just scrolled down, I found.
This might be it. This might be why I know this song. It's probably this video.
Okay. Yeah, we're watching a man play the video game Osu on his computer.
Oh, I do remember this. Yes, this video is iconic.
This too. Maddie, I just saw right in the suggestions for the Hinder video, Megan Dia Monster Nightcore Dubstep Remix.
Let's go.
Hell yeah! Watch
Megan Dia one time.
He's bouncing on the chair. He's getting really into the game. I don't know what kind of game
drop,
he's playing.
The drop.
Oh, is doing a little synchronized dance.
There
they
go.
Oh my god, these boys are zooming.
That's some killer moves there.
Oh well, God.
That's the magic and communal power of anime.
Rip off the band-aid.
No, I'll delay it a little. I have a point I want to make this as well.
Go ahead.
Okay.
Thank you. Because this one got added to the playlist purely because I noticed that for some bizarre reason, it's not too bizarre now, like thinking about it like later, but that this Nightcore version is an official upload from from the band onto Spotify. Mm. To get to get people like listening to their song and to the music in general. And this has become sort of a weird recent trend, and it feels very strange and odd where labels and artists will just upload slowed down or sped up versions of their own songs onto Spotify and streaming services, because that's slowed down and sped up stuff would pop off on TikTok specifically. If you can get those, you can get a version of that song to get big on there, it could get the song really big. This would happen, to an artist like, let's say, Steve Lacy, where a sped up version of this song is an official upload on their Spotify page. And this is specifically bizarre to me because this kind of shit where you just speed up a song and then put it onto YouTube, if you're trying to play around the YouTube copyright system, that's a big no-no because they don't want you putting other people's music on there. And then here we are years later, and labels are just doing it themselves because they realize this is just another way for us to get plays and attention towards our artists and whatnot.
It's TikTok too. TikTok has really sped up that that's probably the biggest reason why there are Nightcore official uploads or sped up official uploads to the DSPs because TikTok has forced their hands of being like, okay, we kind of have to embrace this.
And it's like trying to cut off at the past sort of what would be sort of this organic. And I think that is the thing that is fun about like Nightcore and SoundCloud, whatever this stuff is, that it's organic and fan driven. And they're like, well, no, we need to control that revenue stream. So like, that's where you get like the fucking Gale ABCDFU, where there's like seven different versions of the song. One is like chill version, angry version, nicer version, like literally like one for every emotion, Inside Out style.
This is
like,
this is her just trying to jack that Billy mode style.
Yeah, only Billy is allowed to have modes.
Like, if we're talking about Nightcore, here's like one of the most popular sounds.
Grammy nominated song.
Right,
fucking god.
Grammy nominated song A B C D E F U. Excuse me. Sorry.
It's disgusting.
You might recognize that bass line.
This sounds wrong.
Okay,
this is a big sound on TikTok right now.
I'm gonna go crazy because, like, I know this exists out there, and I don't want to believe it. I have no idea why this is the song you would decide to speed up.
Yeah,
because it just sounds worse. You just made the song worse somehow. Why would you do this?
Yeah, the whole point of this bass line is how slinky it is. Like,
yeah,
like literally one of my favorite songs ever made, and you just kind of like made it worse somehow. Like, good job, guys.
Yeah. Like, the thing is, everything that we were talking about in terms of, like, artists uploading their own, like, sped up or, like, Nightcore versions of their own songs, to me, that mostly just exists in the vacuum of, like, really hyper-aware, like, hyper-online, like, trans artists who know to do that because they see the aesthetic, like, purpose in it, or they find it fun. Like, fucking Devi McCallion did that with one of her songs. Twinkle Park did that with one of her songs. It's like, it's the kind of thing that I expect from that. It's not the kind of thing I expect from like a cis man who makes funk music.
God, just like specifically that, like on Spotify stuff is known as like a sped up version or like slowed down. Like, it's stuff that has like no relation to like anything Nightcore related. Like, none of the people who like were doing that kind of shit is like attached to this. It's all label driven.
Yeah.
I don't want to be one of those people that's like all gatekeep, but if you call it slowed and reverb instead of chopped and screwed, it's just like gentrification.
I have to raise
an eyebrow at you. Pay some respect on DJ Screw's name.
Also, is it frustrating to anyone else that's like Thundercat's third most like popular song right now? Like, he has so much good music in his discography, but that's what you want to listen to? The sped up version?
I don't get it. People will go on here and listen to like
the worst fucking shit. Like, well, like this next song.
I suppose I'd rather them listen to that than Cracker Island.
I like Cracker Island. I like that song.
Here's the thing.
It's a fine song. I have no patience for gorillas in my life anymore.
I feel that. I get you.
I don't anymore. I did think I was out, and then like the local alt station played that the other day, and I was like, you know, this is fine. I'm a big like song machine hater, and I was like, this is better than like all of but like three songs on that album, so like whatever, I'll give it
I'll vouch for Cracker Island, but like that whatever song that I could barely even recall
the Tame Impala on it.
Yeah. We don't need that shit. Get that shit out of here.
Guy out of here.
It's featuring Tame Impala and somebody named Booty Brown that I've never heard of.
Booty Brown is on a previous Gorilla song. He's on Dirty Harry.
Gotcha.
Oh,
sounds
okay.
I'm a big Dima Days apologist, so I'm predisposed to think that song slaps because if you hear it at 11, you hear
wait,
it.
Wait, did you say
the worst
Dima Days apologist? Like, what does that mean? one of the most widely critically acclaimed albums ever.
There's enough like certain people who have like turned on gorillas have like kind of
I think they've turned on gorillas now.
Like being a gorillas apologist, I understand, but like specifically seeing that album,
that is the one that everyone agrees on. I think
that and Plastic Beach.
Plastic Beach is the album ever.
Well, let's rip off.
Speaking
the
of animation,
let's go. Our next song, Marcy. I'll just rip this next song is MTC by S3RL.
Let's go.
What the fuck is this? What is this?
This is happy. This is a happy hardcore song. It's about having fun.
This is to me the worst of what happy hardcore could be. It's only like right that we start on like one of the best happy hardcore songs that like set the genre like in and its future for like years to come, and then one of the last songs is this fucking shit.
Yeah, I think this song is bad enough just with the things that are obviously bad about it, but then you add in the way that he's also doing pop punk voice somehow. Yeah, it's just like, all right, too far.
Yeah, I think to me it's the fact that I can handle the Europeans being co-opted into anime culture. I can't handle the nerdcore shit.
This bit right here. Beautiful, wonderful.
This is hyper pop.
I mean, I do like the synths, but it's like, the whole time I'm just like, I wish this was Bass Hunter Dota instead so that I could not have to hear the lyrics to this song.
Or...
terrible album cover too. Yeah. Disgusting.
It's a fucking glory.
I can't believe that album cover lived on. In, yeah. Like, this is
I feel like,
Spotify.
I talked over it.
Oh, you're gonna make us hear it fucking again.
Yeah. Sorry. I want to kill myself. I want to just kill myself.
Yeah.
I live on the fourth floor of a building. I could just jump out my window right now.
Why did you do this, Marcy? Why do you torture us this way?
Because I thought it'd be funny. And also, I don't know. It's so funny.
Look, Natalie, as the classic Cal 50 quote from the Discord, this is a podcast about torturing your friends because it's funny first. And it's about inflicting pain on your friends first and music second. And after 9 songs of joy for y'all and about maybe 1 or 2 songs of joy for me on that list, but it wasn't... The first 9 songs are like, okay, most of this is just not for me. You know, once I got used to it, I was like, okay, this is not painful. This was painful every single time. I want to kill myself. I'm just going to keep saying it. All right. You know,
this is an interesting kind of like tweak if he didn't immediately go right back into the hook.
Yeah, I know.
This is a classic DJ move. Just like change up. This becomes like a different song. It will just like mix into something else.
I want to hear this in the club.
This is going to sound damning with faint praise, but if you kept a decent amount of the instrumental and just changed the vocalist, the lyrics, the language, the sentiment behind everything, the album cover, all of these different elements that go into it, you might have maybe a listenable song. Instead,
if you make a completely different song, exactly. it could be a good song.
Like this artist has like other songs that are also popular. I could have easily picked the song "Pika Girl," which is about it's like what you will commonly just see like an anime girl like in a Pikachu costume in a YouTube thumbnail. And you look it up. It's a fun time.
This to me is like what I think this is important to include here because I think this is very much we've talked about the very sort of like pure anime culture that gets co-opted by like kind of people who like corrupt it or like the ways that it's like seen as something that's not. This is purely like what people what the kind of like derogatory connotations of it from like outsiders are, but just like if it were just shouting it directly in your face.
Yeah, it's funny. Like I've known this song for like many years, like since like the early 2010s or so, and like knowing it for that long, like just like hearing all the stuff in it, like it sounds so quaint to me, to be honest. Like it's like let me just tell y'all, it could be worse. Like there is some worse stuff out there.
I'm sure.
If you want to think about like where the extent of anime and like happy hardcore music, like where that stuff, like the deep end of that stuff, like you don't want to know. Like I won't put that.
I'm unfortunately well aware of it, but yeah, that's yeah.
All right, do we have anything else to say about this song?
Anything else to say about masturbate to cartoons.
I think it's fun. I think it's a cool song.
The lyrics aside, I think it's fun production. I think it's a fun song. It's a little too campy in some points, and I think I can't tell if it's supposed to be that.
Oh, yeah,
or,
also,
like, I don't know.
It's trying to be Aqua Barbie Girl for people that watch too much anime, and it's close to getting that kind of tongue-in-cheek thing, but it doesn't quite pull it off. It does not.
Yeah, that's another thing. Get rid of the fucking vocoder. It serves nothing.
No, you can't. No. Getting rid of that. No, that's a key part of that song.
I think it works.
Transition that to like a point I was going to make. because y'all made like connections to like various like quote unquote hyper pop artists, and this song specifically. The band 100 Gex, maybe you've heard of them. They have a new album coming out 2022. Get excited! But there's a song off that new record that they've been playing like live. Like if you go like look up like live shows and stuff, like there's one song in particular. I think it's 737, I believe. Like it's the vocal stuff that's having on that song is like almost directly pulled from like this song in particular, like from SDRL. Like it's the same sort of thing. Like I don't know if y'all want to pull up with it, but like take it from me, like I can hear it, and like
I can believe like, that. I mean, this is a very 100 Gex sounding song.
Mm. Very 100 Gex if it were very clearly like made by like a weird horny cis dude.
Yeah, I would like to
it could be so much worse. This guy just thinks anime women are cool.
His pictures online are incredible, worth the trip, worth just like looking through all of his photos.
Yeah, I think there's like a there's sequels and stuff. This song in particular, there's like lore that's like introduced.
You can't tell me there's fucking lore for a song called "Masturbate to Cartoons."
He looks like Lemmy. He looks like Lemmy.
This guy looks great. He's just having fun.
Check out MTC if you get the chance. Song of the Summer.
Oh god,
it is the song of the summer.
It's fun. He makes like normal like happy hardcore stuff if you just want to listen to that. But like he is known for like this and like some other various songs.
Let me see what does Rate Your Music have to say about this guy. Oh wait, I can't use Rate Your Music is a terrible website. It's
borderline unusable. The photo. Yeah, it is. It's terrible.
But, oh, Jesus Christ. Okay. Let's not look at this. Let's not look at this. Let's move on to our final song. What is our final song, Marcy?
Last but not least.
I had to put this song.
Last but maybe least.
It's so good to have an excuse to put this song on a playlist and have people talk about it. Let's get it. It's Yuri, the Only One by the LeetStreet Boys.
I just can't believe this.
This is honestly more unforgivable than MTC to me.
I disagree. I really was not fazed by this. It's hot.
I think it's... this is nerdcore to me. This is I have too many war flashbacks of when I used to be like unironically into nerdcore. This like just... this triggers like my like PTSD, and I want to just like immediately just take a hatchet to my computer when I hear this.
Yeah, like this song, like well, like we've heard a lot of songs that's like, you know, that becomes like a part of like Weeb culture and whatnot. This is a song that's specifically meant like in reaction to Weeb culture. Like it's like like it's people who are recognized themselves as Weebs making music for Weebs about things that they like and think are cool.
If some 41 got really into anime or something like that, and like,
here's
this
the thing:
is what would happen?
And like
the sub 41 vocalist has a better voice than this. Like,
I'm not disagreeing. I'm just saying, like,
I hate this guy's voice. I hate the like very much like wink wink nudge nudge video game reference like lyricism. I hate the fact that the instrumental is clearly like made in GarageBand.
I don't know. I kind of like
this. This is DIY
it.
Here. This is pure indie.
Yeah, Natalie, maybe
on.
You need to be more punk rock.
Yeah, I feel like I've seen this band in a basement, like a few times.
Yeah, these guys only get gigs for anime cons. Like, I don't see them playing like
regular
like venues.
This is like barely Marsh if Chris was less talented and lame. Like,
No, Jackie. That's.
That's your take. I haven't even.
That's my take. I will censor that. I'm censoring that take in post. I don't want people yelling at me.
Cancel.
But if you ask me on the Discord, I'll probably say what it is. I don't care. But on podcast, I don't want it to. It's funny where it's like, oh, in this text message that anyone can screenshot and post online. Yeah, sure, I'll say it there. Well, I've already said it there. I think if you can search for it and find out what I said. I'm not gonna say the band name, but you can find it on your own.
This fucking I hate this bridge.
This part's
terrible. Yeah. No, I hate this fucking bridge. This is where I wanted
like
to
nothing. But yeah, it's like okay, I just kill myself. Just all right in my misery. Disrespecting fucking Fountains of Wayne, Adam Schlesinger,
the goats, power pop the goats,
fucking power pop goats, Adam Schlesinger, COVID-19. We're still coming after you for killing our boy. Okay,
exactly.
We're gonna end you for real. Okay,
this definitely feels very like foundational to a lot of the like Animanaguchi style, although all that stuff is like way better.
Oh,
than this.
No.
Oh yeah, this sounds like no cloud. These people are like not popular, except for like when people share around their stuff and be like, "Can you wave this?" They said you wouldn't make Nintendo wave. What does that even mean?
Actually, you know what vibes this song? This just has like this could be what any we could watch this in any one of the podcast streams, right? Like this feels
yeah,
like
that's what this is.
The level of lyricism is very much YouTube parody.
Yeah,
this is like dying days of like early YouTube, dying days of MySpace shit.
Again, that's just
like
nerdcore. That's just nerdcore.
It's busted.
It does
it's busted
sound
for
like
anime
busted.
Fans.
Oh my god, it definitely does.
As an anime enjoyer, it made me really upset because it just made me. I hate to say I had shame. I don't have shame in watch it, like enjoying anime, but that song, shameful.
Yeah,
it's a look in the mirror sort of situation. Mm-hmm. Is this me?
Okay, yeah, I have a point with this. Okay, so like. Obviously, like around this time, like you know, if you were like getting into like video games and anime and stuff, like that's like if you were trying to talk to about the stuff with people, like it'd be pretty hard because like anime, like for like a good while, like you like it might be weird to hear it from like to like people nowadays to hear, but like anime was not cool for like a good while. Like if you're like in the late 2000s and like trying to find other people who like Fullmetal Alchemist and shit, like. You would have to go to like all these like weirdo anime clubs at like your library or if your school had one and just like meet all these like weirdo people that like all came together because they kind of like anime and like you know or like maybe trying to learn Japanese or something.
And, I think like, Toonami changed a generation though.
Yeah. It was very much kind of like how things shifted around like I wanna say like how especially Toonami got like anime into the households for a lot of like U.S. Viewers specifically, but also kind of there was that like clear sort of like late 90s early 2000s like kind of breaking point where it was stuff like Pokemon and like DBZ like kind of crossing over. That was kind of I think like the point where it kind of popularized into the kind of like common pop culture name check thing. I mean fucking hell, like as we've mentioned before on the podcast, 1 week name check Sailor Moon. But like god it's I see where you're coming from, Marcy, and I think this is very pivotal to helping us really kind of contextualize things in full, but it's also like I have been to like actual like nerd conventions and had to like sit through like bad nerdcore acts like rapping about Rick and Morty to get to like actual talented people. I can't do this anymore. I'm done.
Y'all Rocket didn't add any you're gonna hate the name of this genre, but some people call it hentai rap. I could have thrown
nope,
this
all right,
just
in the podcast. Hopefully you all enjoyed this episode, everybody.
Continue on with my point there. Around this area, like anime stuff wasn't like cool. Like Toonami helped a bunch to like get like shows like Naruto and like DBZ and like Gundam like into people's heads and like enjoying that stuff. And then like later on, like in like as the 2010s go by, you know, like Netflix starts becoming into its own. A site called Crunchyroll like becomes like the destination where like you can stream all your anime very easily, and like over time, like and especially with like an anime like Attack on Titan that just like blows up and becomes huge, like the fandom for anime just keeps like building and building, becoming more popular, and more people like start like hearing about it and recognizing it, and then like more recently like over the pandemic and stuff, like anime just kind of like explodes in a way that like I never would have thought would have happened. Because like in my head, like I don't know if like it feels like it for anyone else, but like anime is like now part of like dominant culture in a way that like I never would have thought like years ago.
Like, it's very much a talking point now in a way that it even wasn't like a few years ago. Like, I know the thing that like I was joking about this earlier, but like the thing that really like kind of kickstarted me back into it was like a bunch of like trans girls that I knew during the pandemic all like tweeting about watching K-On! And that was like the thing that kind of K-On! The best show ever
made.
Best music. Shout out Naoko and Imada.
Oh my god, yes.
But like, yeah, like I'm seeing that all the time now, and it might just be like kind of circling around people who are like into that sort of thing. But it's like, it's very clearly, I think that we've definitely hit like a breaking point where it's like, whenever something like really, it feels like there's constantly like a new thing that kind of emerges and becomes big in like such a small space that like normally wouldn't have happened. It would have been much more of like a slow burn to like get it into like American readers or like viewers' hands. But now it's just like, for instance, like I could just go into a fucking Target and just pick up a bunch of Chainsaw Man volumes.
Yeah. I hear shit from my coworkers just talking about like anime just like all the time. Like they'll just like, you know, just like bring up like Naruto or just like the latest show they saw on Crunchyroll and just like talk about it casually, and it's like a weird feeling. And yeah, also like the point to me just like, you know, like all like the trans girls like coming up and like, you know, finding like having anime as like their own thing, and like I didn't mean to like structure this way, but like when I was like making the playlist, like there, like I did make a good case for like even if like the weeb like what it meant to be a weeb like meant to like, you know, a certain kind of thing to like a specific person, but like in those days when like what anime fandom was like, it was a thing that was like participated by both like boys and girls in a way, like, you know, like boys had like, you know, their Naruto's and like their LeetStreet boys, I guess. Like girls, you know, they're playing Kingdom Hearts and stuff. Like they're like getting into like Vocaloid and like shipping Vocaloid characters with each other and just like having fun there.
Yeah. And that's like, that's a big reason why I wanted to like be on this one. Not only because like I feel like next to like Marcy, like I'm of the like podcast members, like I'm the one with like the next most like anime familiarity, but also just because like that is just like a real big kind of like corrective that I think has been happening and that like it's worth reasserting here, which is that I feel like a lot of the sort of tide with like anime has very much been like reclaimed as like this very inherently like trans space, and especially with like with stuff like K-On! Or any number of like Kyary series, there's just like a number of ways that like I've seen just trans people like very much like just imbue themselves in like how they see themselves in a way that I think like is really kind of to me what makes that like worth it. And that's kind of that especially I think gets into my frustration with these last two songs, which I feel like really perpetuate like these kinds of like very reductive negative stereotypes about what a lot of like outsiders perceive anime fans as, because it's just, it's one of those things where it's like, for me, like I've found a lot of like meaning and worth in it over like the last couple of years, and it's like I feel almost kind of protective. I want to shove them away, be like, get away from her, get a job.
It's me, Marcy Anime, and I'm here to reclaim the song MTC by STRL. This is our culture now. As hard as it to believe.
Oh, yeah. And on that note,
what a way to end it.
Well, thank you for listening to this all over the place episode of the Indieheads podcast. Marcy, Sam, do you have any things that you would like to plug?
This is weird. Like, I was like thinking, I was like, all right, I'm gonna plug my Twitter, but also like Twitter's gonna like seems to be like, dying.
I literally
so,
like a second ago was trying to refresh it and it wasn't for like a minute and a half, and I was like, oh, did it just die while we were recording this podcast?
I've been trying not to look at Twitter while doing this whole recording.
It's a Zoom thing, Jackie. I can tell you that for sure.
I genuinely think we could go to bed and Twitter might not be working. Like,
yeah.
Genuinely. It's gotten terrifying. That bad.
Yeah. How fucking great would it be if this podcast was just a live document of Twitter going down in real time? For real. This would be possible. History.
Honestly, great way to go out. It was a fun episode, and we talked about a lot of great internet ephemera.
Yes. Sam, do you have anything to plug?
I guess listen to my music. It's very influenced by J-pop. It's called Cheem, and I think everyone would like it.
One of the best albums of the year. I will not reveal the position of where Guilty Pleasure is on my album of the year list, but it is very high. One of the best records of the year. The new metal agenda is back, baby. It's good again. Whoa, whoa. That's a reference to I'm gonna pretend like people listening to this podcast is like 5 years in the future. They don't really know Twitter archaeology. That's a reference to the tweeter Drill, who was a very funny man.
Who's that?
The Drill Man.
Who had his own show.
He was a very
show.
Funny man.
Jack Nicholson. You know, he was in The Shining.
Oh, and... yeah. I didn't know he had a Twitter.
He did.
Whatever that is.
Yeah,
he's up on the strip.
You know, he was diagnosed with dementia, and, you know, they just gave him a phone and said, all right, go for it, brother. And we got Drill out of it, you know. So it's great. Just what a wonderful website Twitter is/was.
Yeah.
I 2 weeks ago, I was like, we're recording this on Thursday, November 17th. I was, you know, like, I was trying to be pessimistic. I was like, all right, Elon, it's probably going to go to shit, but like, it's probably going to take some time. Man, Elon really went for the any percent speed run of trying to get a social media site shut down. Honestly, kind of impressive how quickly it's really just like, wow.
With no hacks too.
Yeah.
No internet dumpster no hacks. Fire. Just like, all right, fire these employees. Decrease morale because we fired those employees. Force workers into coming back to the office. Again. Borderline unprecedented to see shit like this happen. We're living through history, baby. And
just tie a bow on everything. Perhaps if Elon had asked his employees to be happy hardcore, maybe then they would have.
That's
we're
right.
Pulling the plug on this. That's it. That's it.
I never actually plugged my Twitter. You can find me on Twitter in its dying days at Marcy_anime. I'll also go unplug my partner's podcast because I think it's good. You should listen to it. Hot Singles. You may know Alexis, who's guested on here, I believe, for like one of the Best New Pod episodes. And
which, speaking of Best New Pod, we will be doing our we'll finally be doing our Cuts episodes. Those will be coming out very, very soon throughout the end of November into December. We'll be going through some of the songs we cut from the 2010, 2011, and 2012 playlist, plus some should have been. So more Best New Pod content coming on the way very, very soon.
Hell yeah.
Hell yeah.
Hell yeah.
Yes.
I'm excited. I'm excited personally as someone who's like been like catching up on the backlog of this podcast, and now I'm like here and I'm like talking on it and people listen to it. I'm excited for it.
Yes. Thank you for being our anime expert this episode.
Thank you.
We would have been very lost. We would have, well, Natalie wouldn't have been lost. Natalie would have been able to tread water.
Even as the de facto like podcast anime expert, I have like maybe 10% of the knowledge that Marcy has. So like, thank you, Marcy, for helping guide us through. That was like a true help in a way that I would never have been able to do.
No problem. I'm sure next time I'm on here, I'll bring some like normal music or whatever that like we'll have like normal things about.
That maybe. Never happens on this podcast.
Never.
Once in a while.
It was a deep dive under the internet, so thank you.
Yes.
Shout
out to online, and thank you both for joining us, and thank you for listening. Good night.
Goodbye, everybody. Someone's there in the night. It's not for singing rap. It's not for making it to art. When you left, there's the house all the way down. When I walk to the room where you were. And look into the empty mess you said. All fails. Hey, 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 hey